All right. Hi. How is everybody?
We got the wrong.
Hi. How are you?
Oh, it's the kindergarten.
Here we go. Yep. Okay. Everybody good? Sorry, we had to look at the screen because we wanted to make sure the slide was right.
Hey.
You may have noticed there's three faces up there, but there's four chairs on the stage with four people in them. So we just, for the first time ever, have a surprise guest on, and we'll get into that in a minute. You're not thought leadering already, are you? Okay, I'm going to talk about the thought leadering thing in a minute. Thanks for giving us your time to be on the stage today. I want to get to know a little bit about who's in the audience first, and then you'll get to know a little bit about who's on stage. And then we're going to talk about this wonderful subject of we have two different things going on here.
Yeah.
Is a connected home actually smart? So just a show of hands, how many integrators do we have in the audience? Okay, manufacturers, distributors, plumbers, electricians, architects, trash people. Okay, what does everybody else do? I'm just curious what your involvement is, maybe. Could you hear that?
Students.
Okay, students.
Students.
I love that. Okay, great. So the way we're going to do our session, look, I almost thought leadered right there, sorry. The way we're going to do our session is we encourage questions, and you don't need to wait to the end to ask the questions. So use the microphones, because if you don't, we won't be able to hear you. And we're also recording this, so we want to make sure everything gets on the recording. So I'm Walt Zerbe. I'm Senior Director of Technology and Standards at CEDIA, and I'm also host for the CEDIA podcast. And you're going to do the same thing as I'm doing, so not only name, title, but a little bit about you. So I've been in the industry for 30-plus years as an integrator, also in product management for 20-something years, making audio products, and in standards development for the Consumer Technology Association and for CEDIA to create standards of how to properly install technology. So that's kind of my main deal, and I'm going to hand it over to Rich.
Thank you, Walt. My name is Rich Green. I work as an integrator in Palo Alto, California, which is where Stanford University is, the birthplace of Silicon Valley. I started volunteering for CEDIA in 1996. That's how I earned all of these ribbons. This is my CEDIA resume, and I'm very proud of this. My degrees are in anthropology and historical geology, and I'm a big fan of humane technology.
Okay, thank you very much. This is our surprise guest, Jesus, and we met last year at this show because I would consider that you were a student then, and you're probably, well, we are all endless students. I would just say if you're in this industry, you probably have a passion for learning and you never want to stop learning. That's definitely all of us up here on the stage. But we literally met last year. He just sat in the session that we just did, and now, after a brief conversation with Rich, you're up on the stage. Rich.
Jesus and I were just talking down here, and the words coming out of his mouth blew my mind. I said, you need to be up on this stage, and here he is. Tell us about yourself.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your words. I am Jesus Delgadillo. I'm a mechatronic engineer, but I've had experience in the industry for 5 years, I think. I decided to stop being a smart home integrator, and then I moved into a master degree in audiovisual innovation and interactive spaces, actually here in Barcelona. I'm just trying to come back as a smart home integrator and try to design and shape the way how we are going to live the houses of the future.
Great. All right. We're going to get into that in a bit. And then we have Christian Bukas.
I'm Christian Bukas. I have a small integration distribution business based in Cape Town, South Africa. I've been a CEDIA volunteer for close on the entire time I've been in the industry, which is pushing 20-something years. I'm very passionate about analog devices. And through my journey as everything from the T-boy to the owner of the business, I've experienced a lot of stuff in the connected home and the smart home. And through that process, looking at products, picking products, designing things for clients. And it's an interesting process to get to, and that's the discussion we're here for today, to talk about what makes the connected home smart, and is it actually smart?
Okay, you heard me make a little joke in the beginning, but does anybody know what this is? Has anybody seen this? Apparently, if you do this, you're a thought leader. And we learned this from TED Talk. So immediately you're supposed to be respected because you know what you're talking about.
We need a globe. Where's the globe?
We need a globe. Yeah,
we need a picture of the world.
Right. So
we're thought leaders.
We're very thought leader-y right now. And Rich, I'm going to appoint you as the co-moderator of this talk because you just had a discussion with Jesus. So, I mean, the way we do our talks is sometimes we have an outline, but given the crew up here and the way we did the last one, we're just going to go through this topic because we all have so much experience in it. So I would like you to work with Jesus right now in the conversation that you just had that prompted you to get him up on stage so we can see what angle he's coming from so we can get our talk going from that angle.
I think the technical term is winging it.
Yeah,
we're
right.
Winging it.
We're winging it.
Well, first I'm going to say the smart home is a stupid home.
Yes.
It doesn't exist. And we've been saying this in the City of Technology Council for years. It's like, no, this is not smart. And then you see Cedia is branding us as the smart home. You can see the smart home tech up on the board there in the education rooms. Nobody really knows what that means. And it depends on your definition and your expectations of smart. Right now we're in a pretty stupid phase of what the smart home is. These are connected devices. So if a device touches the network in some way, either via Zigbee or Z-Wave or Bluetooth or Wi-Fi or 5G cellular data communications, if a device touches the network, it's considered connected. Therefore, it can be you can pull data from it, you can push data to it, you can use an app to control it, and so on. So that's what the smart home is right now. It's a bunch of connected devices, and for the most part, they don't talk to each other. There's been some momentum. There's a new protocol called Matter, which is allowing devices to communicate with each other. And there's a new surprise initiative that I'm going to spring on the group, but I'm going to hold on to it. We're going to let people wonder what that surprise initiative is. But I'm going to come up with something in a couple of minutes. So Jesus has been writing to me and saying, what can I do with my career? Where can I go with this? And I sensed a bit of frustration in him. I didn't realize that he has just completed his master's degree in smart home technology. And now he's frustrated with it. And what he just said down here to me is, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to take this to the next level. I need for the smart home to be a human home. How can I make this happen, Rich? And that just blew my mind. Okay, so we got the future of Cedia sitting right here on the stage. He completed his master's degree, and he was left feeling empty. Why is that? Why aren't we making this happen yet? What left you feeling frustrated?
Well, during my career as a smart home integrator, I just felt like I was trying to give the good experience. I mean, why we need a smart home? Like, why? We were already good, but we are trying to improve the way how we live inside our houses. I felt like there were a lot of equipment and devices that were helping us to be better in a specific ways, but I didn't feel like it wasn't that full. Like, if they were not connected, and even though they were connected, they didn't help at all the way how we live. I feel like we were just going in a way that weren't really helping the way how we live inside our houses. We, instead of being better, we just connected to a reality that is not our real life.
And in many cases, worse. It doesn't necessarily mean it's improved anything. It could have added complication or process or disconnection, right?
Disconnected from real life.
Yeah, well, yeah. Christian.
I think we're at a point where, and I'm going to relate this to the remote control analogy, we used to have many, many remote controls for different devices, and then they all were consolidated into the universal remote control, and that's what our industry sold. We are now at the point where we are back at the multitude of remote controls because we have so many of these different systems.
Good analogy.
How do we pull them all together in a unified user interface? Because ultimately, that is what a home is. It's a machine for living in, and we need to make it work. How do we make it work?
Yeah, I do feel like we're making our lives more comfortable, but not better. That's what I feel. That's what I feel like we're in the place where our houses are not ready yet for a better health, like a better interiors.
Yeah.
I don't know how to explain that.
I think I'm exactly with you, and I'm going to admit something to the audience here. I don't think I've ever said this on a mic or on the camera. I loathe technology, but I'm good at technology. And I've reached that same point and same decision as you that did you read the Integrator 2027 white paper?
Yeah.
You did. Okay. So that's one of the most recent white papers that we did. Every 5 years, we write a white paper where we predict where we think things are going to be in 5 years. Like, what's the landscape going to look like for the integrator 5 years from when we wrote the paper? They were always technical in orientation. We know, what kind of tech do we think we're going to see? And we struggled to write this last paper. We just couldn't get it together with what tech we thought we were going to see. And then we had the eureka, it's not about the tech. It's about the humans, and the tech are the tools. And we completely switched gears with, okay, now we need to really start thinking a lot more about empathy, about design thinking. And I am equally in that same spot of view as, how do we pull it all together? So we're talking about wellness, but that hasn't really reached critical mass at all. But we know there's 100% customer base for wellness. It's all of us. And we talk about living in place, which is a terrible term, or I would like to say assistive tech, to help people with, maybe we all have disabilities to some degree, sight, hearing, maybe it's mobility. Again, how do we, that to me is where a smart home would actually start to become smart, because we've used tech to actually improve the human condition to help somebody in their house. Who would like to expand on that? Am I wrong?
Oh, no, you're totally right. The smart home technology needs to support the humans in the home. How do we figure out how to do that?
But so have we been doing that historically with smart home?
No. We've been connecting things together, just trying to make it work. And then you got companies like Amazon, who thinks they can come into our space with a product like Alexa and just take over. Didn't work. They're laying people off like crazy at Alexa right now. It's a financial bomb. It didn't work for Amazon. Why is that? I think that we're in the trough of disillusionment right now.
Oh, do you want to explain the Gartner hype cycle right now? So does everybody know what the Gartner hype cycle is? All right, go ahead and explain it.
The Gartner hype cycle, the Gartner consulting group started to see repeating trends in technology evolution. And it starts out with the early adopters who start buying something like Amazon Alexa and start playing with it. And then the Alexa comes out with new revs. It gets a little bit better, a little bit better. And then it crashes into the trough of disillusionment. It's like, this is really an awful experience. Why did I bring this in my home? And that's where Amazon is right now. Alexa is not working for them in terms of a business plan. And then something happens, and the technology starts to evolve, and it gets into a peak acceptance of the mass market. And then it tails off again into a long tail of long-term profitability and sales. That's the Gartner hype cycle. So the trough of disillusionment is what crashes a lot of companies. Circling back to AI, because we talked about AI, how can we bring AI into this mix so that it's not a stupid home anymore, that it starts to become a collaborative home, an assistive home, and that digital assistants start to become digital companions? So two things are about to happen, two bombshells.
Okay.
Okay, we found this out last month at CES in Las Vegas.
Yes.
Number one, the digital voice assistants are going to start to work together. There's an initiative afoot. It's quiet right now. It's not really published. Where, I guess I'm publishing it right now. Where
cat's out the bag.
Yeah, it is.
Google,
you heard it first.
And Amazon and Josh.ai, which is a wonderful little company that's built on the Cydia channel, are starting to talk to each other. And we saw a Josh.ai voice assistant on the wall in the Amazon Alexa suite at CES. It's like, what? They're competitors. So we talked to Alex Capisolatro, Cydia board member, founder of Josh.ai. He goes, oh yeah, we're talking to each other now. We're going to be cross-compatible. So you could walk up to an Amazon Dot and say, hey, Josh, turn on the lights, turn on the TV, close the garage door, and let's get that thing going in the other room. Complex, concatenated sequences of requests like that cannot be processed by Amazon, but they can by Josh. But you can say it to your Amazon product and vice versa. You can say to your Josh product, Alexa,
yeah,
turn on the lights. So that's a big thing. This is what takes the smart home disparate, fractured marketplace and starts to make it uniform so that they can achieve market scale. They're starting to figure this out.
Yeah.
So that's a good development. The next thing that we heard, also from Alex, from Josh.ai, he just casually said, oh yeah, yeah, we're looking at ChatGPT. Boom! I went, oh my God, that's it.
Does everybody know what ChatGPT is out here?
Okay,
all right, well, we're going to explain it, and then if you haven't messed with it, you have to mess with it. So
oh,
go ahead.
Oh, geez. ChatGPT is
awesome.
is an AI that you can communicate with using text prompts, and it'll write poetry, write a novel, write a legal document, write a medical assessment. It's very adept. It was trained on all the human printed knowledge up to the year 2021. So what I've been complaining about with these things is, even with ChatGPT, it's a large language model. When the large language models start to merge with true knowledge creation, which is generative AI, and then you merge that, pointing to Jesus, you merge that
with Jesus,
the smart home, and the digital assistant, now the digital assistant is not so stupid. You can start to have a conversation with it. You can say things like, hey, I'm working in my office and it just got dark outside. Now it knows I need to turn on the lights, go to the light switch, status on. And it starts processing that kind of stuff. So it's a different world when you merge something like a ChatGPT AI with what were pretty stupid voice assistants that were just flipping switches on and off. What do you think about that? Both of you guys.
Would you like?
Yeah, who wants to go first?
Well, when we look at where we're at the moment and the scenario you've just described, we're still, as a majority of integrators, looking at a if this then that model. We're sitting at the early days of massive machine learning. The house has generated information. It has sensors that can sense how much sunlight's coming in, what the angle position of the house is relevant to the sun. What the temperature is on the floor, the thermostat, what the weather is outside, and you can utilize all of that data. But we've just been really terrible at doing that. The last 5%, and there's a CDA course about getting to that last 5% and making it work, that last 5% is the icing on the cake. It's the last 5% that makes the system perfect. It's the last 5% that engages the humane aspect with the tech that's been installed in the house. And this is dumb tech. As much as we call it smart because it's connected to the internet, it's not. All it's doing is it's taking a state and reporting back on it. What we're doing with that is the interesting part. And how we do that is going to change rapidly given the ability to write code in English, just speaking to something. The ability to take that process and have it code the system for you. You used a beautiful example of a young gentleman who wrote an entire script on for Apple, and he did it in under an hour, just basic interactions, and he automated the entire house.
He automated Siri. He plugged Siri into ChatGPT using JavaScripts, but he didn't write the JavaScripts. He just used natural English speaking to ChatGPT. ChatGPT wrote it for him, and he created an extremely smart Siri, and he did it in just a few hours. He wrote the English prompt in about an hour, and then ChatGPT wrote the code that Siri operated on. He had the whole thing. His whole smart home was operating with voice conversation in less than one day of work. What does it take us to make that happen? It would take months and months of expensive engineers in our companies to pull this off. You can do this in less than one day, but you can charge like it took you 3 months. This is a huge opportunity, and it's happening right now.
Yeah.
Well, reading the question, is the connected home actually smart? I truly believe that it is not now, but we're on the way to make it possible. Right now, I think we're focusing ourselves in make things connected. Like we're connecting smart TVs, we're connecting shades, lighting. I was talking to Rich and I was telling like I was trying to create furniture that can be also connected, that can reshape itself. So in the future, we'll be having a lot of devices and most of them will be connected. So what will come next and what we are doing right now is trying to connect in a way that our lives will be better, like more pleasant. And it's fine. It's really good for what we have right now. What we're talking is that we believe that we're going in a direction where we might interact with our houses, with our minds. So between these happens, we believe that AI can help so much on the way how we interact with our houses. We believe Nest is doing something like this really good. Like he's trying to learn how do you behave so it can control the climate, not the climate, the HVAC,
I don't know how to call it.
Yeah. Even without touching it. So in the future, I feel like we're gonna be training our AI, our house. We're gonna be training our house in a way that if you do, like, I don't know, if you just wake up for 2 weeks in the same way, your house will understand that you will need to, like, if you always turn on your lights every time after waking up and you like to listen to the music, well, it will give it to you without even saying it.
Yep.
And if we reach Neuralink, that will be like mind-blowing because we are going to be having AI and also mind control of your house. It's not a fact, but that's
when you say mind control,
what
are you imagining? What does that feel like?
What is it? What, a brain-computer interface? Are you talking about that, BCI?
Like a brain-computer interface?
No, like or mind. I just think like, turn off this light, please. And
so you're thinking, turn on light.
Yeah.
And the light comes on.
Yeah.
How do we get there?
Well, connected to the internet, then the internet connected to the controller send it. Well, of course there's AI on the controller, but
BCI,
the controller will turn this off.
But what's picking up the brain waves?
What?
What senses the brain waves?
Not really sure exactly.
Duct tape.
Okay. Well, he's inventing that.
Duct tape fixes everything.
It's getting there. Elon Musk is working on.
Yeah.
What I'm hearing and what I also agree with is we're in an ugly period right now, just like with energy. Right now, energy is a mess and a problem. There is going to be an abundance of energy within our lifetime. I know we've talked about maybe 10 years we're going to have commercially viable fusion. That's going to change, but that's going to change things for us a lot. So I'm hearing the same thing with the smart home right now is, well, you know, we're going to use the term smart home because it's the marketable term, but I guess the connected home. We're in a real quandary, messy period right now. So I guess the questions are, we can go two ways with this. One, how do we think it's going to go, which we've been going down this path with this conversation right now, when we do have usable AI that is in the home, versus, I'm going to throw three at you. That's one. The second one is, what do we do during this ugly period to try to make a home smarter? And we're going to always go back to the conversation that we talk about a lot, which, Christian, you can chime in on right now. What type of sensors or things are we going to need to deploy to try to make this interaction between humans and the AI or human in the house now a better actual experience to improve someone's life?
There was an initiative started by Google about 3 years ago, which is to take Google Home, the Google Assistant, and add anticipatory algorithms and predictive analytics to the data that they're acquiring about how families move around and behave in their homes. Like Jesus said, the breakthrough of the Nest thermostat by Tony Fadell was that he turned it into, first of all, it was a beautiful thing that you can grab, touch, turn.
Analog.
It was analog. It felt like a knob on the wall. That was one thing. But then, as Jesus said, the algorithms start, the sensors inside the thermostat started to realize, when do people come home? When do people leave the house? What do they do with the thermostat? How quickly do they turn up the heat? What's the accelerometer saying? and they start taking that data and turning it into predictive analytics so that you don't have to touch the thermostat anymore. And that's what you're trying to say, is we shouldn't have to touch the smart home anymore. It should just understand our behaviors and become, it recedes into the background. That's the awkward stage we're in right now.
Yeah.
So
Jesus said train.
Yeah. So it's the magic sauce is, how do we understand human behaviors in such a way that they don't become annoying? Right now, Alexa is already annoying to me because I get up in the morning, I go downstairs, I turn on the news radio, and I start making my breakfast, and then she interrupts me and she goes, I've noticed that you've woken up at the same time. Would you like me to blah, blah, blah? And I just say, no, don't do that. I just shut up. I don't want you right now. So it's trying.
How many people swear at their voice control?
I do.
I do a lot, and I say absurd things just to either
ignores
me or
says. And they detect that. They're doing artificial emotion detection, and they're trying to figure out what your emotional state is, and then so that the response is more appropriate for your emotional state. But how do we get out of this trough of disillusionment? It's an awkward period right now. It doesn't feel good.
Yeah, Christian.
Well, the big thing with those two scenarios were the fact that the one of them is akin to machine learning, massive amounts of data being produced by the house, and the other one is that, but driven by something which has a very human interactive capability to it. The scenario that you sketched earlier is already here. We have a lot of that control happening because Lutron has been running stuff like that for years. If you use a Lutron system in your house and you put it into vacation mode, all it does is it repeats the last 2 weeks of your life. It turns on the lights. If you went to the bathroom at 3 o'clock in the morning, the light in the bathroom will go on Tuesday at 3 o'clock in the morning. That's what it will do. But that isn't smart. That's just connected. It's just learnt from the past. And I think this is combined with what we do as humans, and this is what makes it difficult, because as humans, we are biased, we are irrational, we do strange things for no reason whatsoever. So you go downstairs.
And we're random.
And exactly.
Completely
and that's
random.
What makes it difficult. But with the coming of integration of systems like ChatGPT and the voice assistants that can all talk to each other and the way that that predictive analytics is working, you are going to find that the system is now capable of having, within a couple of parameters, a response which is based on variables that it can then track while you're in the house.
Yeah. Before we go to a question, and I'm really glad that you're standing there to ask one, that's where Jesus is future stepping. That's where he's saying we need the BCI interface so that, because that's the only way to address our randomness. What you talk about, reading emotion, I think I'll get up now. So, okay, you're going to need the lights on. And I'm going to walk to the bathroom. Oh, you're going to walk to the bathroom. So I see the end game, but this medium state is really, really tricky to try to get that to happen. So I know we could keep chiming
ball,
in on this.
Ball,
I don't want to... What?
Humans. Ball. That's exactly what happens. That's why that interface works. It's because we're talking about one thing and the next thing, you know.
Yeah, squirrel. All right, please, just give us your name and ask the question.
Hi, I'm Jack. I wanted to hear your thoughts about actual connected health devices. So, actual sensors that are on the body or in the body and things like that. And the kind of incompatibility of the timelines where connected health devices, anything you see in a hospital now was invented 10 years ago or more, and it takes such a long validation time to actually get it on people for safety reasons. But like you were talking about before, exponential growth of technology, AI, things like that, they don't evolve at the same rate. How can we integrate actual sensors? That means the AI doesn't have to interpret external things about us as what we need and want and what our body's doing. If we have actual sensors that are giving us that information, then that can feed in, but those sensors take a long time to develop, and I just wanted to hear your thoughts on that.
Before you guys start, because I know we're all chomping at the bit to get on this. What where do you come from? Like, what part of the industry? What do you do? I'm just curious.
I'm currently a junior integrator, but I did a uni course. I'm an electrical engineer, and one of the modules was connected health.
Okay.
And so that's where my interest stems from that.
All right, before we go to Rich, this is a massive category that affects everybody in the room, and we will all be doing this because it's one of the number one human conditions, right? So,
yeah. I have a success story to share with you. By the way, you're hired. Give me your card. My success story is a client of mine in Palo Alto who has an 8-year-old son who has type 1 diabetes. This kid has been on the verge of death since he was born. And my client said, Rich, help me. How can we use this technology that you put into my house to keep my son alive? So he reached out to our friend Mike Maniscalco, who lives in Florida. He was the technology council chair for a few years. And so my client said, you know Rich Green? Ho, small world. So Mike and I collaborated on a technology, diabetes intervention technology, where, and I don't know the name of the algorithm, but I can get you hooked up. So there is real-time blood sugar sensing available right now in the form of a smart home device. You can get the data. So what we did is we acted on the data. So when the kid is going into an insulin crisis, the lights start flashing through the Lutron system via an HTML code sequence that flows through Control 4. So the HTML, the diabetes blood sugar sensor sends an HTML string to Control 4, which Control 4 can interpret into a command that tells the lights in the master bedroom to wake up Dad. And then Dad is like, okay, and then we need to wake up the kid because he's got some sugar in his bed right over his head. So then we start flashing the lights on the kid's bedroom, and then we start playing music louder and louder and louder, and we get the kid's attention. Dad finally gets out of bed, goes down to see if the kid responded. So that's what we did. It works 100% reliably. The magic sauce is in the diabetes detection. So Mike Maniscalco also has a child, an infant, born with type 1 diabetes, and he's on the verge of death as well. So Mike is very much invested in this space, and he's gone very far into it. So we'll get you connected with Mike Maniscalco. He'll show you how the algorithms work with the blood sugar detection device, and then how we can move that through more traditional channels, Control 4, Lutron, etc.
Yeah, thank you for bringing us back on track to the wearables and to the sensor part of this discussion. CES every year is loaded with more and more sensors. It was the year of toilet OS. So there were so many smart toilets at CES that can instantly give you results on your health, which, by the way, urine is one of the greatest ways to find out what's going on. There were tons of manufacturers that were focusing on smart toilets. So we're going to be interfacing all these things. And where it's going to get really messy, so the sensors are coming and the sensors are here. It's going to be putting them together, and how do you make sense of them? Is the data all the same data? How do you get all the data consolidated, and what do you do with it? So it's going to, I see a whole industry rising until AI can help us write the code for us. What do you do with all that information and actually make it useful when you're being flooded with it from all these sensors? How do you prioritize it? How do you all of it?
Well, that's the discussion that we need to have, and part and parcel of the medical devices interfacing problem that we have is, to paraphrase a quote, we have Paleolithic emotions, we have prehistoric institutions, and we have godlike technology, and those three things don't work well together.
We have a crisis of
humanity, because we are stuck in the political nightmare of making sure that devices don't kill people. We're stuck in the nightmare of having to make sure that everything is legal, and all of that bureaucratic BS takes years. the problem with technology is technology doesn't wait for years. It scales very quickly. We need to be able to balance how you take which device and how accurate it is, integrated with the systems, but also do so at a price point which is relative and relevant, because that's the other difficulty. As much as those devices are ubiquitous or becoming ubiquitous, they still cost a lot of money. Last year at CES was, you know, we saw not only the toilets, which is where the irony of the situation comes from. Is who's ever seen the movie The Island with Ewan McGregor? Yeah, no bacon for you, no bacon for you. It measures through the toilet how much salt is in his blood, and therefore says you're not allowed to have bacon this morning. And he complains about bacon because he wants to win the lottery. Anyway, I digress. It is exactly that scenario. We have this mountain of information, we have speed of development, but we don't have the potential at the time to then purchase the products en masse to allow it to happen. And we're getting to a point where this is all coalescing, and it will come to fruition.
It will take very large companies with a lot of money and clout with the regulatory agencies to make it happen. It's beyond Cydia. We have to wait for them to develop these sensor networks and the communication and the medical approvals and all that. What I'd like to do now is
we do have a question. How big is that one? How big is your thought?
It's big.
All right, I figured. And I have a fairly decent one myself. So let's go to the question, because I don't want to have you.
Don't worry. If you wanted to say it.
Yeah. Give us your question and your name and you're
a
student.
It's not as a question. It's like an idea.
Okay.
After you, before you were saying something about intelligence, right? For me, the minimum of intelligence is that one gadget do the action that you want to do, whenever you want to do, and you don't have to say to the gadget do that action. Like there are some t-shirts that they call intelligence fabric, but they are not really made of intelligent fabric. They are only waterproof fabric, and that's it.
Yeah, it's just like when I at CES one year when we were all there, I went by a stand that had a smart water bottle, and I said, "What's smart about it?" And he said, "Well, there's an app." And I said, "Well, what's smart about that?" And he goes, "Well, it tells you how much water's in the bottle." I said, "Well, the bottle's clear. I can see how much water's in it." He goes, "Oh no, it's smart though. There's an app." So right with you, yeah. That's marketing, and maybe to our advantage. But I don't know if you're going to talk about this, Rich, but I just want to make sure it gets addressed. We know where the future's going to be, and we're going to be able to actually make a much smarter home. But I just want to make sure before we leave everybody here today that we talk about maybe some tools that they can do in this messy interim period of how they can make a home serve someone better, and some through tools like design thinking and things like that.
It's not exactly where I was going to go.
But you can go where you want to go first, and then you can address that.
Okay, so I'd like to follow on with what this young man just asked us.
Yep.
Let's say the big companies figure out how to get the data from the sensor network into a usable form that becomes actionable in some humane way. So skip ahead out of the trough of disillusionment into the peak of acceptance, where the period of enlightenment in this technology. What can we do with it? What do we do with that data? What can the digital companion, the little guardian angel that floats on your shoulder all day long, do for you? And that's what I want to hear from Jesus, because that's where you're heading. I mean, you've already skipped the hard part, and you're imagining some really cool things to do on the other side. What would that look like?
Well, I truly believe that in the future, AI and mind control things will be partnering, or will be together, so in order to make things better. When AI won't work in the way we believe it should work, we're going to control it with our minds with an instant. Well, I think, there is a huge gap right now. We also another thing that I wanted to say is that, okay, we're gonna understand how we behave, but also we're gonna be having data from other people, how do they behave, how we can improve our lives. Like, we will have also models, like, if I understand that you have better habits than me, I will also, I could add a profile on my house, and I will add your profile in order to mix with mine, and it will create better habits in my life. So
that's great, wow. And also prioritization. What happens when you both walk into the room? What does it respond to? Your preferences on the lighting or their preferences on the lighting? I mean, it gets complicated.
Yeah, but well, we feel like there is these quantum machines coming. There are a lot of devices that will allow us to control these data and try to transfer into better sorted data in order to understand that this is yours, this is your data, and how we can match and how we interact between each other, not only me in the house. And no, it's all about our family and the people living there.
I think there's an important topic that we haven't addressed here, and that is the topic of privacy.
I was just going to bring that up. How do we manage this data?
We're all generating this data, and who's owning it? Where is it going? What is it happening? Is it staying local to the house? Is it staying, you know, is it going past the house to just the edge of the driveway where the car is? Is it going with the car to the office? How are we integrating those chains? How are we looking after the client's information? How are they entrusting us with their well-being? Because that's ultimately what they're doing. And I think we are at that precipice. We're climbing out of the trough of disillusionment because we have access to these tools. What I would recommend for an integrator is to cut your 5-day work week down to 4 and spend 1 day a week just playing with technology, figuring it out, having someone in the office mess about with stuff, buy the new gadgets, figure them out, spend time learning about it.
And how you might apply it.
Exactly.
To not just understand the gadget, but how you could actually use it to improve or help somebody.
And perhaps use the gadget for what it wasn't intended to be used.
A friend of ours, another associate with the Technology Council at CEDIA, is Gordon Van Zuyden. He has a wonderful company in Los Gatos, California, called Cyber Manor. And his business is about smart home. He's not so much into AV as he is into smart home. He's a master at smart devices. What he did is he built an experience center. He turned his garage in the back of the office into an experience center. He worked with interior designers. It's beautifully designed, and it's completely full of all kinds of stuff. Smart shower, smart toilet, smart light, smart toaster, smart everything he can get his hands on. And then what does he do? This is a stroke of genius. He did two things. He turned it into a metaverse experience. He completely mapped it in 3D so that you can go to his website, you can click on that Lutron keypad and start playing with the lights, and you can click on the shower and you can make the water start running, and you can kind of play with it in a 3D metaverse environment. And then, what did he do? This is a stroke of genius. He turned it into an Airbnb. So he rents it out to people for an entire weekend, and a family, if you will. It's got all the bedrooms, all the clean. It's a nice Airbnb, but they're required to give them feedback on their experience after the session.
It's brilliant.
Yeah, so he talks to the family. What did you like? What didn't you like? How could I improve this? You can do this.
Yeah. The last future thought I would like to say, you're spot on, I think. I had a discussion with Poppy Crum. She was the chief scientist at Dolby Labs, and she was on a podcast. And she has done a lot of study on stimulus and how we all respond differently to when we're being entertained, what our pupil dilation is, how much CO2 we release when we're scared or when we're excited. And so we're all unique. And I asked her, do you think we will have a profile on each one of us someday that would then could be loaded into our electronics, and then a presentation could be given knowing that this is how Walt responds, so we could get the ultimate response out of Walt. I think that persona or that tag that could eventually be created for each one of us, and then that will help us to interact with our technology.
Persona, key word. We have a question over here.
Yeah, oh, yeah. We're a little over time, but we're good. We're not late.
It's not, yes,
it's working.
You. Hello. Well, excellent timing. Actually, it's a bit awkward. I came to this microphone 10 seconds before Christian started about the subject of privacy, and my, well, I was precisely going to talk about that. You already started, that's a good thing, so I'm going to go on with my view. I would like to come back to this example you quoted about this child with type 1 diabetes, and the solutions you brought to an actual problem, which is actually great, but this comes at a risk, a cost, in terms of privacy, and in terms of security, which are two different things. For example, let's say, so you have this crisis when there is a blood sugar problem for the kid during the night. The technology helps dealing with that crisis, possibly saving the child's life. The next day, the father receives an advertisement. Oh, something happened to you last night. Let's go this product. Let's have chocolate. And all. I don't think you want that. And let's say you live in an apartment and your neighbor hates you. And your neighbor learns that you have a device at home that can wake you up at 3 or 4 a.m. Oh, I like that. I like that. I'm gonna hijack your house and wake you up at 3 a.m. panicking because you think your child is having a trouble. So you're already starting talking about that, which is great. You talked about connecting all the devices you have in a smart home together, which has an implication. It throws one principle of security down the toilet, which is security by isolation. So what are your thoughts about how to mitigate that, both for privacy and security reasons?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, because I was also going to bring in what role blockchain and encryption needs to come into this. So Rich, you want to?
Yeah, blockchain is the long-term answer. Short-term, it's not quite there yet. But blockchain is a distributed ledger that it lends itself naturally to micro-authentication of secure digital assets. So if this child's data about diabetes is a secure digital asset, blockchain can be applied to that data so that you can only let certain people have access to that data, and it is rock solid. So other hackers won't be able to get through the blockchain micro-authentication process. We'll get there. We're not there completely yet, but I think that this is how the metaverse is banking on keeping the metaverse private. If you create a digital space, a virtual space in the metaverse to play games in, what's to prevent Walt from coming in and spraying graffiti all over it? Well, almost nothing right now. So blockchain would give me a way to lock down my space so that only the people I authenticate can come in and spray graffiti on top of it. So we're not there yet, but I think blockchain is the answer. But we're in an awkward period of blockchain, obviously.
Yeah.
And it consumes a lot of power, and it's got all kinds of problems.
It's not too scalable right now.
We're going to get past it.
All right. We're going to have to, unfortunately, stop the talk. And we could go on for another hour. But, Rich, I want to thank you very much, Jesus and Christian, for joining me up on stage today to talk about this awesome topic that affects all of us. And all of you for giving us some time to sit in the audience. So thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody.